What happened here at Auschwitz was so monstrous that I think when American and British and Russian tourists come here, they're tempted to derive a certain satisfaction from the idea that in fighting Hitler, the Allies were waging a just war. It's terribly easy to forget that in pursuit of victory, the Allies also, in different ways, meted out death to innocent men, women and children. This wasn't simply a war between evil and good. It was a war between evil and lesser evil.
The years from 1943 to 1945 were the cataclysmic crux of the 20th century's War of the World. But the defeat of the German and Japanese Empire states was less of a victory for morality than we tend to assume. The Allies were forced to make terrible compromises to defeat fanatical enemies. It seemed as if the war could be won only by turning against them their own inhuman methods. November 1941, 2 years after the beginning of the Second World War in Europe. After the devastating losses inflicted on the Soviet Union by Operation Barbarossa, a second offensive had taken Hitler's army to the very gates of Moscow. On November the 1st, with the Germans just 40 miles away, Stalin decided to proceed with the usual ceremonies to mark the anniversary of the revolution. The event was held in the ornate and bomb-proof halls of Mayakovsky Square subway station. Stalin had a defiant message for his former confederate Hitler.
If they want a war of extermination, they shall have it. Our task now will be to destroy every German to the very last man. Death to the German invaders.
But this was the language of desperation as much as defiance. By the summer of 1942, Hitler's forces had overrun the Baltic states, Belarus, and the Ukraine. All continental Europe was his. Japan, meanwhile, had achieved astonishing victories in Asia and had swept across the Pacific, seizing island after island in a devastating centrifugal offensive. By the summer of 1942, you really needed to be an optimist to think the Allies would win the war.
To explain how the Allies ultimately won the war, it's not enough to point to Hitler's strategic errors or the inadequacy of the Axis powers' supplies of men and material. The Allies had to beat powerful new empire states that had used the tactics of blitzkrieg to carve out vast tracts of resource-rich Lebensraum.
Despite heavy losses at Stalingrad, by the summer of 1943, the Nazis were still deep in Soviet territory. They still had hopes of reaching the oil fields of the Caucasus. The decisive battle of the Second World War was yet to take place.
What happened here in the stormy days of July 1943 simply takes your breath away. The Kursk salient is a vast battlefield, almost the size of Wales. It takes about 3 hours to drive from one end to the other. The German strategy was a classic pincer movement, two huge armoured thrusts from north and south. The Soviet response was to defend in depth, to lure the Germans into the salient and obliterate them.
Lined up on the eve of battle were the forces of Armageddon. On one side, 3,000 miles of trenches, 400,000 mines laid, 3,400 tanks, 19,000 guns, 1.3 million men, two-fifths of the entire Red Army. And on the other side, 900,000 battle-hardened German soldiers, the pride of Hitler's Wehrmacht. At Kursk, the Nazi army met the Red Army on the Germans' own terms. Tanks, the most lethal weapon in the arsenal of the Blitzkrieg, faced tanks on a vast battlefield.
This, far more than Stalingrad, was the decisive turning point of the war. But it was the achievement of a combination, Soviet manpower and American capital.
Hitler had long assumed that the Americans were a hopelessly decadent, racially mongrel people. That's why he was so ready to declare war on the United States in solidarity with Japan after Pearl Harbor.
I don't see much future for the Americans. In my view, it's a decayed country. The German Reich has 270 opera houses, a standard of cultural existence of which they over there have no conception.
It was a crucial strategic miscalculation on the part of the Japanese and Germans to think that they could win a war against the United States. They had made the common mistake of believing that with the Great Depression, the American economic model had disintegrated. But when it came to mass producing the means of destruction, the United States proved to be more than a match for the totalitarian states. Ironically, the heartland of the free market mutated into the ultimate command economy as America's giant corporations all but fused with the planners of the Pentagon. Yet the Americans did more than just equip themselves. Setting ideological differences aside, they also sent massive supplies to Stalin's Soviet Union.
We shall send in ever-increasing numbers. Ships, planes, tanks, guns. That is our purpose and our pledge.
A particular favorite with the Red Army was the Jeep. The soldiers joked that the letters USA stood for Ubitsukina Sina Adolfa, to kill that son of a bitch Adolf.
It wasn't an aspect of the Great Patriotic War that Stalin was particularly eager to publicize, but it was crucial. On the eve of the Battle of Kursk, Soviet commanders talked to each other on American radios. Lining up on Soviet airfields were squadrons of American-built fighters.
The Red Army that faced the Germans here in the summer of 1943 was thus a very different force from the one that had all but collapsed in the summers of 1941 and 1942. Now, this was in large measure a result of American assistance, but it was also without question a consequence of Stalin's near total control over his subjects' lives.
It might have been expected that in the crisis of war, Stalin would suspend the terror. On the contrary, it became an essential component of Soviet warfare.
This is a copy of Order No. 227, issued by the People's Commissar for the Defense of the Soviet Union, in other words, Stalin, on July the 28th, 1942. What do we lack, asked Stalin? The answer was discipline. And he had a simple solution. Panic mongers and cowards are to be exterminated on the spot. In addition, Stalin introduced punishment battalions for anyone convicted of trying to desert. The men of these punishment battalions were to be the cannon fodder of the Battle of Kursk.
The Western Allies always insisted they were fighting the Second World War for freedom. On the eve of the Battle of Kursk, it was obvious that this was the last thing on Stalin's mind. In order to defeat an enemy they routinely denounced as barbaric, the Western powers had made common cause with an ally that was morally little better, just more ruthlessly effective at waging total war. In Mein Kampf, Hitler had pledged to wipe Bolshevism from the face of the earth and create in its place a new living space for the German folk. But to make a living space, there first had to be a killing space. Finally, in the middle of the vast Russian plains, it came down to this. The German offensive in the Battle of Kursk, codenamed Citadel, was timed for 2:30 on the morning of July the 4th. There's never been a July 4th like it. At 2:20 precisely, General Georgi Zhukov unleashed a ferocious preemptive bombardment. So deafening, it sounded to him like a symphony of hell. Germans were caught by surprise, but pressed on, relying on the superior firepower of their Tiger and Panther tanks. Eight days after the battle had begun, two massive tank armies literally collided. At first, scarcely anything could be seen in the smoke and dust. The Soviet tank commanders had to steer their tanks with the pressure of their feet on their drivers' shoulders. Then, torrential rain liquefied the battlefield. When the fighting finally stopped, all that remained was a ghastly morass of burnt-out tanks and charred bodies.
In the space of just 2 months of intense fighting at the battles of Stalingrad and Kursk, the Red Army lost almost as many men as the British Empire and the United States in the whole war. This was what the Soviet journalist Ilya Ehrenberg called deep war.
For weeks after the battle, the whole region remained, as one war correspondent put it, a hideous desert. There had never been a conflict like it. It was pitiless. It was remorseless. And yet, it surely could not be endless. Both sides suffered roughly equal casualties at Kursk, but because their army was smaller, German losses were more serious. In the succeeding weeks and months, they were driven back relentlessly. Kursk seemed to demonstrate beyond a shadow of doubt that Germany could not win the war.
The British certainly thought the war might be coming to an end. In this astonishing document from just 2 months after the Battle of Kursk, the Joint Intelligence Subcommittee told the War Cabinet that it was possible Germany's situation was as bad as it had been at the same time in 1918, that the war might end before the end of 1943 with a German collapse. How could they have been so right about the ultimate outcome of the war, and yet so wrong about its timing? Why did the Germans and Japanese keep fighting after 1943, when every rational hope of victory had disappeared?
By the time 60,000 American troops landed here at the island of Okinawa on April the 1st, 1945, they had already had a bitter taste of the Japanese cult of death. Suicidal banzai charges in Attu. The horrific spectacle of Japanese civilians killing their own families rather than surrender in Saipan. Then, as the troopships approached the Okinawa beaches, they were attacked by hundreds of kamikaze aircraft. On board one of the landing craft was war correspondent Ernie Pyle. He had heard enough from the Marines to know what to expect from a race that seemed, quite literally, inhuman.
A Jap officer and six men were surrounded on the beach by a small bunch of Marines. They could see the Jap giving emphatic orders to his men, and then all six bent over and the officer went along the line and chopped off their heads with his sword. What code led the officer to kill his own men rather than let them fight to the death is something only another Jap would know.
One young man who did understand this code was Saito Matsuo. Matsuo was one of hundreds of university students who in 1942 came to the National Stadium to attend a grand recruitment ceremony in front of Prime Minister Tojo.
I was standing right in front of Tojo when he gave his speech. He said something about, "You are fortunate and privileged to have the opportunity to sacrifice yourselves for His Majesty the Emperor."
To be a soldier is the highest human achievement in Japan. He has been trained to be a soldier almost from birth, and into his tough little mind has been drilled and hammered the fanatical belief that Japanese are descendants of gods and destined to rule the earth and all who live on it.
Saito Matsuo knew what that meant.
You see, the Japanese army had no concept of surrender. Even if there was no hope of beating the enemy, you were still supposed to fight to the end.
Yet it was not only the fear of dishonor that deterred Japanese soldiers from surrendering. This footage was taken by an unknown combat cameraman in 1944 during fighting on the Pacific island of Peleliu. These Japanese soldiers had been wounded, but were still alive. In his diary of his experiences in New Guinea in 1944, the celebrated American aviator Charles Lindbergh noticed the same thing.
Our men think nothing of shooting a Japanese prisoner or soldier attempting to surrender. They treat the Japs with less respect than they would give to an animal.
The attitude of the Allied soldiers reinforced the Japanese perception that since prisoners would be killed by the enemy anyway, it was pointless to surrender. Better to fight to the death. This was what happened on Okinawa, on a massive scale. The island's densely forested ridges and rocky embankments made it an easy place for the Japanese to fight a protracted battle of attrition. The southern end of the island was honeycombed with caves that had been specially reinforced to create an almost impenetrable defensive warren. The Marines had to fight cave by cave. No quarter was given. This truly was war without mercy. In Okinawa, 75,000 Japanese combatants, determined to fight to the last man, died rather than surrender. 28,000 civilians and soldiers were buried alive by the Americans as the caves where they were hiding were blown to kingdom come.
It's not easy to distinguish the Japanese army's self-induced aversion to surrender from the perfectly rational fear that the Americans would kill any prisoners that they took. What is clear is that as the Pacific War progressed, the cycle of violence became increasingly brutal and blatantly racial, and the feelings of racial antipathy were decidedly mutual.
On May the 22nd, 1944, Life magazine published a picture of a winsome blonde from Arizona gazing at a human skull. A memento mori, perhaps, in the tradition of the metaphysical poets? On the contrary.
When he said goodbye 2 years ago to Natalie Nickerson, 20, a war worker of Phoenix, a big, handsome Navy lieutenant promised her a Jap. Last week, Natalie received a human skull, autographed by her lieutenant and 13 friends, and inscribed, "This is a good Jap, a dead one." Natalie, surprised at the gift, named it Tojo.
Such things happened because in the eyes of many American soldiers and civilians, the Japanese were no longer human. In this respect, too, the Allies were unwittingly adopting the core ideas of the enemy they were fighting.
Beneath the thin veneer of a few generations of civilization, he is a subhuman beast who has brought warfare back to the primeval, who fights by the jungle rule of tooth and claw, who must be beaten by the jungle rule of tooth and claw. Kill him, or he will kill you.
Clearly, the Australian general Sir Thomas Blamey regarded the Japanese in the same way that Germans regarded Russians, as Untermenschen. As Blamey went on to tell his troops, their foes were a cross between the human being and the ape that had to be exterminated to preserve civilization.
The United States had already embraced the command economy. Now the war against the Axis had forced the Americans and their allies to adopt another of the defining characteristics of totalitarianism. They had dehumanized the enemy in order more easily to kill them.
The vast war graves cemetery on Okinawa is a monument to the way the Western powers had begun to replicate the behaviour of their foes. Here, Japanese reluctance to surrender meshed disastrously with the Allied desire to avenge the atrocities committed against their own men. The effect was that the intensity of violence actually increased, even as the chances of an Axis victory diminished to zero. How on earth could this most bloody phase of the War of the World be ended at a tolerable human cost? It was the answer to that question that grounded the young cadet Saito Matsuo. He was training for his first, and one would presume his last, kamikaze flight. But it was a mission he never flew. On the night of the 13th of February 1945, 773 British Lancaster bombers set off from bases all over the south of England to bomb the German city of Dresden. Officially, they were going to hit troop trains destined for the Eastern Front, but the main railway bridge leading eastwards wasn't even targeted. The aim of the mission was quite simply to kill German civilians. Among them was Victor Klemperer, formerly the professor of Romance languages here at Dresden's Technical University. One of the city's few remaining Jews, Klemperer had kept a diary of the way the Nazis had systematically deprived him of his job, his civil liberties, and eventually his home. By the end of 1944, it seemed only a matter of time before they sent him off to the death camps. But what if the other side, the supposed good guys, got him first?
15th of September, 1944. In the morning, dark glowing, deep purple dawn, as I washed myself and looked out at the Corolla Bridge, I could not stop imagining this row of houses suddenly collapsing before my eyes. Until now, Dresden itself really has been spared.
Klemperer's predicament symbolized the warped morality of the last months of the war. As he was about to find out, his salvation, and that of all the Jews still left in Europe, could be achieved only through the deaths of hundreds of thousands of other human beings. In the final act of Wagner's Götterdämmerung, Twilight of the Gods, the climax of his epic ring cycle, the heroine Brunhilde restores the stolen ring of power to the River Rhine and hurls herself onto her dead lover Siegfried's funeral pyre. The fiery conflagration then topples the stronghold of the gods Valhalla in an almost unstageable apocalypse. Hitler's lifelong obsession with Wagner's music had made it the official soundtrack of the Third Reich. But this was to be the twilight of the devils. According to one intercepted communication, Hitler was planning to embark alone in a plane carrying bombs and blow himself up in the air somewhere over the Baltic. The intention was that the fervent admirers of the Führer among the German people would believe that he had become a god and was dwelling in heaven. This was to be Brunhilde's immolation scene in a Messerschmitt.
If they'd been rational, the Axis leaders might have moderated their conduct in anticipation of a future peace, in the hope of somehow diminishing the Allies' appetite for retribution. And indeed, here at Bevzets, where 500,000 Jews were hideously suffocated to death, the Nazis did try to conceal what they'd done. They literally landscaped over the death camp. They planted those trees up there. They even built a fake farmhouse. Yet elsewhere, at Auschwitz, the killing didn't just continue. It was stepped up. All of Hungarian Jewry killed in 1944. It was as if the nearer they got to defeat, the more fanatically the Nazis pursued their goals of violence towards those in their power, as if they were willing the final apocalyptic act.
Across the territory still controlled by the Nazis, the so-called final solution of the Jewish question was pursued in a mood of mounting fanaticism. The worse the crimes they committed, the less the Nazis could conceive of surrendering themselves to the judgment of the Allies. As Goebbels put it, if we have to leave, we'll close the door behind us with a slam that all the world will hear. The Axis powers had treated the civilians of countries they occupied with an astonishing brutality. Now, it was payback time.
The Nazis entered this war under the rather childish delusion that they were going to bomb everybody else and nobody was going to bomb them. At Rotterdam, in London, Warsaw, and 50 other places, they put that rather naive theory into operation. They sowed the wind, and now they are going to reap the whirlwind.
This directive was sent from the Deputy Chief of the Air Staff to Bomber Command on February the 14th, 1942, and it states quite explicitly, the primary objective of your operations should now be focused on the morale of the enemy civil population.
What the Allied bombing strategy meant was that a rising proportion of first British and then American resources was to be aimed at the destruction of German and Japanese cities. In other words, the slaughter of civilians in those countries. Men, women, and children.
This was precisely the policy the US State Department had denounced in 1937 as unwarranted and contrary to principles of law and humanity when the Japanese had started bombing Chinese cities. And it was precisely the policy Neville Chamberlain had dismissed as mere terrorism, a policy to which His Majesty's government would never resort.
When Hamburg was destroyed in a firestorm codenamed Operation Gomorrah, between 35 and 50,000 people died. Tokyo was literally incinerated in a raid that killed between 80,000 and 200,000 people. Yet for the Jewish diarist Victor Klemperer, strategic bombing was to mean unintended salvation.
February the 13th, Tuesday afternoon. Perfect spring weather. We sat down for coffee at about 9:30 on Tuesday evening, very weary and depressed. Waldemann had assured me with very great certainty that those to be deported on Thursday were being sent to their deaths and that we who were being left behind would be done away with in a week's time.
But February the 13th was to prove deadly in a very different way. not just for Jews, but for all the city's inhabitants. For it was now Dresden's turn for Allied payback.
A full-scale warning sounded. Very soon we heard the ever deeper and louder humming of approaching squadrons. The light went out, an explosion nearby. Approaching aircraft again. Deadly danger once again. Explosion once again. Suddenly, the cellar window on the back wall, opposite the entrance, burst open, and outside it was bright as day. Fires were burning. The ground was covered with burning glass. A terrible, strong wind was blowing.
And yet, even in hell, miracles can happen. Clambering out of the shelter specially designated for Jews, Klemperer was able to rip the yellow star off his coat, and in the ensuing chaos, he and his wife were able to make themselves scarce. They kept his identity concealed until the war was finally over. Ironically, if it hadn't been for Bomber Harris, we wouldn't now have what was almost certainly the most insightful and penetrating account ever written of life and death under the swastika.
The attack on Dresden remains the most controversial of all British operations in World War II. At the very least, 35,000 people died. Was this carnage in any sense justifiable? Although the damage strategic bombing inflicted on civilian morale was far less than had been predicted, the effect on the German and Japanese war effort was undeniable. Of the escalating moral costs involved in defeating an enemy prepared to fight to the bitter end.
What happened at Hiroshima and Nagasaki is usually seen as having ushered in a new era, the atomic age. And yet in many ways it was just the logical conclusion of 4 years of Allied strategic bombing. But what the A-bomb did represent was the extent to which the Western powers were prepared to throw aside all moral restraint in the determination to end the war and get rid of the Axis Empire states, no matter what the cost. It remained to be seen just how high that cost would be.
They did not greet us, nor did they smile. They seemed oppressed not only by compassion, but by a confused restraint, which sealed their lips and bound their eyes to the funereal scene. It was that shame we knew so well, the shame the Germans did not know, the feeling of guilt that such a crime should exist. No one has ever been able to grasp better than us the incurable nature of the offense.
Those are the unforgettable words of Primo Levi, who lived to see the first Soviet troops reach the gates of Auschwitz on January the 27th, 1945. Scenes like these were repeated at concentration camps all over the disintegrating Nazi Empire.
The Soviet advance arrived much too late for those who had the misfortune to be sent to Bevshets. All the Russians found here was buried ash and bones. And yet, wasn't there something paradoxical about the idea of liberation by the forces of the Soviet Union? After all, there were camps and mass graves not that far to the east of here. A regime that had invented the Gulag had no serious interest in liberation in any meaningful sense.
Within weeks of taking possession of the Buchenwald concentration camp, the Soviets were using it to incarcerate political prisoners of their own. The faces seemed much the same. All that had changed were the criteria whereby they were deprived of their freedom. The concentration camps of Eastern Europe were merely under new management.
The privilege of opening the first trial in history for crimes against the peace of the world imposes a grave responsibility.
In the Nuremberg trials, the Soviets and their victorious allies struck splendidly sanctimonious attitudes.
The wrongs which we seek to condemn and punish have been so calculated, so malignant and so devastating that civilization cannot tolerate their being ignored.
In Tokyo, the charges against the Japanese leaders who stood trial in this courtroom included the wholesale destruction of human lives, not alone on the field of battle, but in the homes, hospitals and orphanages, in factories and fields. Yet this had been the very essence of the Allied policy of strategic bombing. Both sides had committed inhumane acts against civilian populations.
The crux of the victor's case was that the German and Japanese leaderships had premeditated and unleashed aggressive war and set in motion evils that had left no home in the world untouched. And yet where had the Soviet Union been in 1939? And as for inhumane acts against civilians, that pretty much described the treatment that had been meted out by the Red Army to ordinary Germans in 1945.
As the Red Army had advanced westwards in the final months of the war, more than 5 million Germans had fled their homes for what they hoped would be the safety of the fatherland. Danzig, today's Gdansk, was jammed with German refugees from miles around, desperately looking for a way out.
The scene here in the port of Gdynia in January 1945 was little less than apocalyptic. Tens of thousands of German refugees were pouring in, desperate for evacuation westwards. This was their only hope of eluding the marauding Red Army, whose artillery could already be heard thundering in the distance. So the 6,000 or so Germans who managed to scramble aboard the former pleasure cruiser, the Wilhelm Gustloff, must have thought they'd struck it lucky.
Wilhelm Gustloff, look after
The Wilhelm Gustloff had been launched by Hitler before the war as a cruise ship for happy Aryan holidaymakers. On the evening of January 30th, 1945, it set sail from Gdynia into the freezing waters of the Baltic Sea. The ship was hunted down by a Soviet submarine, and at 9 p.m., it was hit by 3 torpedoes. It sank within 90 minutes. It was the worst shipping disaster in history, with a death toll 5 times that of the Titanic. Nor was that the only Allied war crime of the war's last year. After their occupation of the eastern half of Germany, including Berlin, Soviet soldiers raped as many as 2 million German women.
Did Britain and the United States feel no qualms as the crimes of the Nazis were repaid with new crimes by their Soviet allies? Well, if so, they kept them to themselves. Churchill said he trusted in Stalin to keep his word, But by May 1945, trusting in Stalin's word was nothing more than a pious hope. All of Eastern Europe lay under his iron fist. Suddenly, the Western powers looked a lot like totalitarian fellow travelers.
And who had really won the war in Asia? The main beneficiary of victory over Japan was once again the Soviet Union. By August 1945, Stalin had his hands on Japanese-occupied Manchuria, and the first Soviet troops had crossed the Korean border.
Finally, the Chinese communists, with Stalin's indispensable support, took over the most populous nation on Earth.
By 1950, many people in the West felt justified in asking, who had really won the Second World War?
We allied ourselves with a dictator who was every bit as brutal as Hitler. We adopted tactics that we ourselves had condemned as depraved, killing prisoners and bombing civilians. And yet all of this isn't to imply some kind of simple moral equivalence between Auschwitz and Hiroshima. The Axis cities would never have been bombed if their governments hadn't launched wars of aggression. And they would have kept on killing people had it not been for the determination of the Allies to prevail by fair means or foul. But what I do want to acknowledge is that the victory of 1945 was a tainted victory, if indeed it was a victory at all.
As Primo Levi wrote, no peace could ever efface the crimes that had been committed in the war. And not only those committed by the losers.
So for us, even the hour of liberty rang out grave and muffled, so that we should have liked to wash our consciences and our memories clean from the foulness that lay upon them. We felt that now nothing could ever happen good and pure enough to rub out the past, and that the scars of the outrage would remain with us forever.